All right, we're live on YouTube for those who are excited about that kind of thing. Okay, and what I'm going to do is go ahead and
Okay, so what will be the order of our talks?
I'd say that's up to you guys to set. I'm going to futz around with the live streaming and just make sure I'm ready to answer questions there.
Okay. It will be better if it will start with the talk from Denis. Then I will continue. Or if we will have lightning talks, we can put lightning talks before my talk.
Actually, nobody contacted us for lightning talks.
Maybe Robert has something to say about. Robert,
you know, I think it would be good to probably spend 3-5 minutes to talk about licensing, because this is probably a hot topic after Elastic.
Yeah, you know, I think that one's a hi everybody. By the way, if folks are coming into the to the meeting, we're just getting set up. We'll be ready to go in just a minute. Got a little bit of communication stuff we're working out. Yeah, I might mention that for a minute. I think because I'd like to, because for example, Alexi and I haven't had a chance to talk about it. I don't want to go too deep into that. But it's definitely a topic I think we'll return to. So what we'll do then, so Denis, you'll go up first, and then followed by Alexi. So we'll just start off with the usual intros. I'll talk about I'll welcome everybody, and then we'll also talk about what's the next meetup coming up, which we very likely will have one in February. I haven't scheduled it yet, but we've already got some interesting topics to discuss. So more startups. And then we'll, and this is going to be recorded. I've got it paused right now, but we're recording on the stream is recording right now. And we also have the, a recording on Zoom. Sorry, I always get discombobulated when I have to manage Zoom and YouTube together. It uses both sides of my brain. So with that, hi everybody, welcome. If you're here, please go ahead and what we'll do is, actually, since we don't have a huge number of people here, if you'd like to kick things off, I'm going to go ahead and allow you all to talk, and you can just step up and introduce yourselves and just say who you are. So I just unmuted Anna. So if you want to just introduce yourself, go ahead.
Hello, my name is Anna. I'm from Russia. Now it's a bit late here as well, as for many others. I'm working in a company Valmis, and we started to investigate ClickHouse and how it works, but on the very beginning level. So we'll see how it will go.
Wonderful, welcome. Let's see, next on my list is Filippo, if you've got audio.
Yep. Hello, I'm Filippo, I work at Sentry. We've been using ClickHouse in production before I joined. And yeah, we love it.
Awesome. And I think you and I have met before. So
yeah, we did.
Thank you. Thank you so much for coming to the meetup. I've got Adam Peavy next on my list, if you want to say a word or two.
Yeah, sure. My name is Adam Peavy. I'm an infrastructure engineer at Disney Streaming. And we're just looking at ClickHouse to do some log analytics, just kind of browsing. So yeah.
Awesome. Next on the list, Deepak Jindal.
Hi, my name is Deepak Jindal, and I work at a healthcare company called Nuna. And we have recently started using ClickHouse in production, and we love it too.
Wonderful. Great. let's see, Sergey Belogorov, if I'm not mistaken, if you want to say something.
Yeah, hello, привет. I'm working at analytics company and called Attribution App, and we're looking like looking at a ClickHouse to fulfill some, like, to remove some bottlenecks. So, yeah, I'm quite excited what we can do with this. So just researching yet.
Okay, I'm losing track of who's on the list. So if somebody else wants to pop up, anybody who's unmuted, go ahead and introduce yourself.
Yeah, I'm unmuted. Can you hear me?
Yes.
So I'm Bharat. I am an engineer at Cloudflare. So in my free time, I also contribute to ClickHouse. So I started contributing to ClickHouse last year in June, and so far I've been loving it. It's a great community, and Alexi and other folks are really, really helpful. So I would like to, you know, stay put, you know, for more interesting changes that are yet to come.
Great. Anybody else want to go ahead and introduce themselves? Please step up and talk.
Hey, how are you guys doing? Svetoslav here of Countess Cat Incorporated. We're still testing ClickHouse, and test results are great so far. So we're trying to teach our app to use it now instead of MySQL.
Great. More intros. I've got people coming in. Please go ahead. If you're able to talk, you can also send me a message through chat if you're having problems talking, but please go ahead and introduce yourself.
Hi everyone, this is Sachin. Sachin Goel. I am principal engineer at Rollbar. We just deployed ClickHouse in our production, and I'm just here to observe how these meetups go.
Awesome. Welcome, Sachin. Any more intros? Don't be shy. Okay, so we'll. There are many more people. We've now got 22 on. Sorry, we're using this webinar format, so you can't see each other necessarily. I'd like to dive in. We'll be going here for an hour and a half or 2 hours. This is our traditional office hours. It's the third time we've done this. What we try to do is get the most expert people in the world on ClickHouse together, have them talk a little bit about what's happening in the product, and then answer any question you can throw at them. So, just to, some intros. My name is Robert Hodges. My only purpose here is to ensure that we can stream onto YouTube properly and kind of manage questions and do the stuff like that. In my day job, I'm CEO at Altinity. We have with us today, in order that they will probably be speaking, we have Denise Jaravlev. Denise is well known to anybody who's on Telegram. You'll see him there as Denny Crane, which I found out is kind of like a two-level joke. Maybe he can explain it. But so Denise has been using ClickHouse for many years, and he'll be up first with a talk about interesting new features in ClickHouse. Next is Alexei Milovidov. I think most people here probably know Alexei. He's the original designer of ClickHouse and is still the person who manages, probably merges more stuff than like the next 10 people put together. So Alexei, welcome. And Alexei works at Yandex, who are, of course, the original owners of ClickHouse. And then finally, we have Alexander Zaitsev, who is CTO of Altinity, one of the earliest people to use ClickHouse in Angular outside of Yandex. He's been working doing this professionally since 2017. He was one of the founders of Altinity. So with that, we're going to dive in. We have a couple of talks, as I said, coming up, Denise followed by Alexei. Just a few organizational things. This talk is being recorded two ways. We're streaming onto YouTube. So you should be able to, that's being recorded. Anybody who's on YouTube, you can also ask questions. We'll be watching for them and we will answer them. It's also being recorded through Zoom. When we get done, I'll cut it up into pieces and we'll post all the parts. So you don't have to take super frantic notes. As far as the answering, asking questions, you can post them into chat. There's a Q&A box. That's probably the best place to throw questions out as they come up. Feel free to throw them out as the talks are going on, and we will dive in and either answer the person talking, will either answer them in passing or we'll get them at the end. And we're basically here till you run out of questions. So anything you can think of to stump us, those questions are most welcome. With that, I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to Denise to talk about ClickHouse features. Denise, I think you're muted.
Yeah.
Now I got you. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. Sharing screen. So this my talk is about new features. Do you see my screen?
Yep. Yeah, you're up. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So it's not for new users, new customers of ClickHouse, because it's about latest features. But if you're interested in normal stuff, you can check ClickHouse channel on YouTube, and it has a lot of videos. And Altinity channel also have a lot of videos, and you can check them, and you will see how fast ClickHouse and how it's friendly for people and for new customers. So this my talk, it covers probably about last 3 or 4 months of development of new features implemented, but it covers only small parts. It's probably most important part and most interesting for me, but it's the ClickHouse has so long change list. It's insane. Yeah, so let's start. So Yandex and Vitaly Baranov has implemented a new feature. It's like a gRPC protocol in ClickHouse. And now you can access ClickHouse using gRPC, and it's disabled by default, but you can uncomment it in config XML or by another way, how we usually do it using conf-d or config-d as subdirs, and creating new files, file, and gRPC work on 9100 port by default if you uncomment it. And we have an example in GitHub. It's an implementation, sort of implementation of ClickHouse client in Python, and it can emulate ClickHouse client, and you can do normal queries. And actually, it has even interactive mode, I think. And one more feature, it's actually two features. It's ZSTD and Brotli protocols have been implemented. And ZSTD was implemented by Abby Palangashvili, and probably it's some student from Moscow or something. And another Brotli protocol was implemented by Alexey Milovidov from Yandex. And now you can read Brotli files and gzip files using file functions or file table, or you can send files using curl or CTP protocol, and you can, that files can be compressed by or streams can be compressed by Brotli and ZSTD. So now ClickHouse support contain encoding like gzip, deflate, Brotli, XZ, and ZSTD. And this is cool because like a couple of months ago, I edit compressed files support into GZPC driver, and now I need to add some more descriptions for ZSTD and Brotli. This is also another one great feature, new data type map. And this is potentially a huge deal because probably most of you used nested columns, and it's sort of emulation like table in table using the ClickHouse arrays, but it's another approach to the same thing, and probably one day it will be super huge feature and super funny, and I'm actually have a great expectation, and I'm waiting for this. And this feature now it's working only for string data types, but now you can put a map data type into table, into column, and probably one day it will allow to use arbitrary data types. But now it's like it looks like this. You can sort of put sort of JSONs or maps into column, and you can select them like this. Originally, ClickHouse had only union all SQL operator. Now, Flynn, it's a Chinese developer, I believe, he implemented normal union, and you can query union, but it requires to set additional setting to behave as distinct, because it's actually not free feature. It's heavy from CPU perspective, so it should be enabled implicitly. Yeah. Another feature, it's a performance improvement from Nikita Mikhailov from Yandex. It's parallel formatting for data export. It will improve performance for formatting of TSV and CSV and so on formats. And it's it has actually huge performance improvement. So as you can see on this example, this query improved 3 times. It was 3 seconds, and now it was 9 seconds. If you disable this feature, it's enabled by default, so it's now it's 4 seconds. It's more than 2 times, almost 3. And probably if you have more columns and it has different data types, it could be faster, maybe 5 times. I saw it on one example, but I had a lot of columns, so I didn't put it here. Probably it will improve GDPC protocol because it uses TSV tab separated format. And as you can see, the user time, it's almost the same as before, but it's because of ClickHouse client worked multi-threading. And so the real time, the time that you will see, it has quite improvement. So I'm not an expert. I don't have skills in this feature, but it it allows to do like a sort of fuzzy search or semi-duplicate search, and you can help. It has Flynn from, I think, China. Yeah, he implemented several functions, and these functions allows you to do fuzzy search for text. Probably, so it's a simple example. You can calculate similarity of strings. Several statistics functions were implemented by Nikita Mikhailov from Yandex, but I don't have skills on this at all. So I can understand what is rank core, for example, do, but I don't know about these functions. Probably if you do statistics, you'll know more about this. So it's I put simple example. Here it's like number and number minus 33. It has obviously correlation one. So it's sort of example of this, yeah. Another feature from Altinity and from Vladimir Chebotaryov, it's actually a great feature. And I like it because I work as DBA mostly. And this feature allows to put mutation, place mutation only for some partitions, not for all table, but for partition. Right now, ClickHouse updates, mutate all partitions, all parts in table, and it needs, because in case of, it needs for consistency, because in case of ClickHouse rebooting, ClickHouse start to mutate table again, and it needs to know what partitions existed before. So it for consistency, now it mutated all partitions, I think, and now you can mutate only dedicated only specific partitions. So I put here a simple example. So I created a table, I inserted rows, and if you select parts, you will see like a part identifier 003. If we mutate the table in old way, you will see that all parts were mutated. It has a mutation identifier in both partitions, but actually we have a filter, okay, a condition, and only one partition in that case need to be mutated because it's partitioned by month. So using new syntax, you can place a partition only for one or for a specific partitions. And in this example, you see that only one partition permutated in the result, specific partition. But it, as I understand, it works only for replicated table, and it probably a huge feature. It allows to do less zookeeper communication and less disk IO, because in case of original mutation, all parts mutated, and ClickHouse creates a copy of all parts, but it's not a complete copy. It's a copy using hard links, but still new behavior allows to reduce random IO and disk IO drastically. One more feature from Altinity, from Mikhail Filimonov, it allows to detach table permanently. So now you can detach table, and if you detach table and attach table, these operators allows you to sort of restart table. So when ClickHouse shut down, it's do detach and this, and when ClickHouse start up, it attach all tables. So detach, it's allows you to remove table temporary from database or from running instance and do some stuff on the disk, and you can attach it back. But I use this detach attach on running instances sometimes, but if ClickHouse restarts in the middle of my maintenance, it will attach table automatically back. And sometimes it's not very convenient. So now we can detach table permanently and do maintenance without worrying about restarts and automatic attaching. Here's an example, detach table, restart, do select, and we see that table T doesn't exist, and we can attach it, and you see that table exists. One more feature, it's extended optimized deduplicate. It's from Antinity, and it was implemented by Vasily Nemkov. And maybe you don't know that, but ClickHouse has a deduplication feature for merge tree table. It has for only plain merge tree. It has sense only for plain merge tree tables, because other tables, they like replacing merge tree or summing merge tree, collapsing merge tree, they actually sort of deduplicate, they collapse rows by themselves by primary key, by sorting key. But for plain merge tree table, it doesn't collapse rows, and it stored duplicates. And if you run optimized table final deduplicate, it will deduplicate and it will remove exact duplicates from the table. So if you have like several rows with absolutely all content in all columns, you can deduplicate and you can collapse these rows into one column. But now you can collapse not complete duplicate. In this example, I inserted three rows, and these rows different in these two columns, and I ran optimized table deduplicate by all columns except some column one and some column two. So it's like this column. And you see that table deduplicated and only one row remain. And it selects only first rows probably. I think it's any, but mostly, in most cases, it will be first row. So yeah, it's a cool feature. Yeah, and
Denise.
Yeah,
it sounds like there's, I see at least one comment on this. I have a, can you talk about performance of this? Like, is it just like doing an optimized table?
Yeah, it's obviously it has performance impact. It's regular merge, and it will rewrite, it will read all partitions if you run it against all tables. So it will read all partitions and it will write using merge algorithm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so yeah, it's usually if you don't, it will create a huge impact. As usually, you can check that optimized table final documentation said about impact on CPU and the disk. So don't run if you have like high response time requirements. If you need real-time queries, don't run this against instances with real-time queries.
Thanks.
Yeah, so Vasily implemented many different ways to run this deduplicate command. You can run using set of columns which you need to deduplicate, run against all columns except some columns, even using regular. But it's a common feature for ClickHouse. You can query select in the same way. One more feature from Cloudflare, from Nikolai Vortomei, and this feature allows you to drop part. So ClickHouse allows, from the beginning, ClickHouse allows you to drop partition. Sometimes you need to drop not partition, but parts. So partition actually, it's a logical entity. It's sort of parts. Every insert creates a part, and after that merges, they combine these parts into new bigger parts. But set of parts, they actually partition. It's a logical thing, and parts is physical things. It's and sometimes partition, but a part. So, for example, I created a table monthly partitioned, and these two inserts, because it's two inserts, they created two parts. So, as you can see here, we have in one partition, and now we can drop. Part. Why do I need this syntax? Sometimes if your table is not replicated, you can actually lost data because of disk corruption or bit rot, and sometimes you will be able to read the column, for example, in some part. So now you can drop not partition or only one part if this part is corrupted. Or sometimes if your merges are stuck because of some communication problem with Zookeeper, or if the part replicas lost part because of spontaneous reboot. And for example, your merges can stuck. And it happens very rare, but sometimes it could be drop or detach partition, or detach not partition, but only one part. So if you lost one insert, and this part exists only in Zookeeper and doesn't exist on the disk, you can drop one part and fix your mergers. So if you need it, it's a great feature. Yeah, but you need it very rare, but sometimes you need it. One more feature from Anton Popov from Yandex. This actually feature removes empty parts. So if you use TTL, you can see that you can observe that after TTL removed all rows from the table, it leaves empty parts in the table. These parts has zero rows. It means nothing actually. It's inconvenient that you see these parts. It doesn't have any performance impact. But now this feature, it removes the empty parts, and this is great because we saw a lot of complaints about that parts not removed, and a lot of questions in GitHub, what is going on. Now all questions are resolved. So now it's all empty parts are removed. One more feature from ByteDance, from Sandy Lee, and it's a new engine. It's embedded RocksDB engine. It's a common RocksDB, well-known RocksDB engine from Facebook. And this is a very fast K-value store. The same store is used in MySQL and other databases. And this engine has nothing common with ClickHouse. It's a completely external feature, but now you can have this table with storage, and you can use it for example, dictionaries. What this engine can do. So you can actually insert rows, and using insert row with the same primary key, you can actually update row. So here is an example. Currently, ClickHouse doesn't have a delete feature, but you can emulate using another column, like delete column. And place a flag like deleted. Yeah. And why do we need it? Yeah, because this engine allows to do very fast update. So mutation is not fast because on merge tree table, it rewrites parts with deleted or updated columns. And this engine allows you to do immediate, very fast updates, instant updates. And you can use it if you use, if you need it for dictionaries, or you can with instant update, or you can use it as a substitution for MySQL or SQLite. So for example, I have a upload process and I ingestion process into ClickHouse, and I control some ingestion tasks, my ETL task in MySQL, which near ClickHouse. But now I can implement this inside ClickHouse, and I don't need MySQL anymore. Another feature, it allows you to query aggregate results in more consistent way with standard SQL. So it's from Flynn from China. And it allows, now ClickHouse can, it's fine. I export it into PDF and you don't see now here. But originally ClickHouse, when you query aggregate functions on zero rows, for example, here you see the zero in the max, but it's inconsistent with SQL standard because the result can have to be null. ClickHouse doesn't calculate now here because of performance reasons, because nullable columns create a performance impact. So originally ClickHouse calculated into zero, and it's inconsistent with SQL standard. But now you can enable this setting. You can enable it in the query or in the session or in user profile, and you will get more consistent with SQL standard, more correct from SQL ANSI result, and you will get null here. So probably if you use BI tools and you need to get like proper results, sometimes consistently for results from other databases, you should enable this by default. One more feature from AmazBird, it's command table expressions. And now ClickHouse allows you to do more command table expression in common convenient way, and you can chain queries, and you can query in second query the previous and so on. And so yeah, it's a standard command table expressions. We don't implement all features of command table expression, but the most used is implemented now. One more feature from AmazBird. He's also, by the way, from China. And this feature allows to prune partitioning, eliminate partitions during select for arbitrary partitioning. So now, for example, in this example, I put partitioning by mod. So if you have a table and you have a sort of tenants and you have 1,000 tenants, you cannot partition by 1,000 because it will create a lot of partitions. So you can create sort of buckets and combine tenants into the buckets. So in this case, in this example, in every month, you will have 100 partitions. It's not very good actually for performance, but from insert perspective, and it creates more partitions than original ClickHouse design expect. So ClickHouse originally designed for monthly partitioning, but now we have custom partitioning, and this custom partitioning allows us to partition in any custom way. So if we partition like this by tenant mod 100, if we query a table by tenant ID equal 42, for example, you will see that it was processed like 1,300 rows. And if we disable partition pruning by identity function, this actually identity function does nothing, but it's quite useful for debugging, because if you sort of ClickHouse optimizer unable to see through identity function, so it can't optimize, cannot do partition pruning in this case, and you see that without partition pruning, ClickHouse queried 3 million rows, not 1,300. And before this feature was implemented, actually we can emulate the same behavior, but we need to add additional columns, and we need to add additional predicates to the select query. So it was before like this. Now it's more convenient and more natural. One more feature from AmazBird. It's a simple aggregate function now are supported in Xamarin Merge Tree as the same way as aggregate functions. So now you can use a simple aggregate function in Xamarin Merge Tree. I think most of you know that Xamarin Merge Tree calculates sums automatically. So Xamarin Mesh 3 is a great engine, and if it automatically calculates sums for all columns, for all numeric columns which are not included in order by key. So in this case, we have some sum column, and it will be calculated using sum, because we have country in city in the order by key. For non-numeric column, Krighaus calculate values using any function. So if you by mistake doesn't include city, for example, in the key, it will be corrupted, it will be calculated by any. And don't forget to place all your dimensions into the order by key. So let's continue. So now we can calculate max, mean, and so on, all functions, aggregate functions, which are available for simple aggregate function. And we can calculate, we can use simple aggregate functions in Xamarin Mesh 3. So now Xamarin Mesh 3 became complete substitute for aggregating Mesh 3. And we don't need actually aggregating Mesh 3 anymore, probably, because Xamarin Mesh 3 has more features than aggregating Mesh 3. And this is the end of my presentation. Thank you.
Hey, thanks, Denise. There is a question from Sachin, which I think came up about 10 minutes into your talk. And here, I'll just read it out for you. Do we have any metrics on how mutation changes helped in speeding up the process? Also, is that part of stable release already?
Yeah, it's a part of stable release already, and we don't have metrics. It's I didn't measure it because to show the proper results, you need to have huge database. So you need to have like production with billions of rows and probably with huge number of shards and so on to see the difference. You need to have a lot of partitions and a lot of data to see the difference. But if you have a huge installation, you already know that you need this feature.
Okay. And here's a quick one, which I think is not directly related to your talk, but might as well take it. Is there a way to create a dictionary that resides in the same ClickHouse instance without specifying the username and password?
I remember that probably Alexei can answer it, because I remember he created an issue about this, and I think it was implemented, but I'm not sure.
Yes, I remember that I have created an issue, but I don't remember if it was solved.
Yeah, check the change log, or ask me in Telegram. I can check it, because I have a feeling that it's solved.
Cool. Hey, speaking of Alexei, if there are no more questions about this talk or the new features, Alexei, if you want to go ahead and take over and talk about roadmap, you're on.
Okay. I cannot share my screen.
Oh, here, let me.
Denise will stop sharing his
screen. Yeah.
Okay. So I have a small presentation about ClickHouse roadmap. But the roadmap itself is huge. The good news is that you don't need my presentation. ClickHouse is open source product, and ClickHouse roadmap is also publicly available on GitHub. in GitHub issue. And in this presentation, I will only show you some highlights, only about a few features that are in the roadmap. So what are the main tasks? We have plenty of them, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, probably 20. So let's start with something. First is support for nested data structures with multiple nesting and for semi-structured data. The development is already in progress, and we have something to show you in the latest version 21.1 that was just released in Monday. So we already have some support for complex data structures like tuples. Also, we have named tuples, less well known. Recently, we have map data type, and from the beginning, we have nested data type. So what has been changed? If you do some query with select from nested subcolumns, now it will read only required subcolumns. This was already implemented this way for nested data structure, but now it is already available for named tuples. And now you can also combine nested data type, and you can have nested data inside another nested data. For example, if you have a table with from e-commerce website, and you have events about purchases, and every purchase have multiple items, and every item has multiple features. So you can use two-level nested for this purpose. And you can query fields from multiple nested data from arbitrary depth. And this maps naturally to nested JSON and protobuf. So you will be able to enable setting to import and export deeply nested JSONs into ClickHouse. And this is just the beginning of quite a large task to support semi-structured data. What is next? And this is very anticipated feature, window functions. It is already in progress, and some part of this feature is already implemented and available in version 21.1 if you enable experimental flag. So what is already supported? We support aggregate functions over windows with user-specified partitioning and user-specified order. We also support window close after from, so you can specify your window and refer this window by name. What is not supported yet, but will be available, I hope, very soon, is support for non-aggregate functions over windows, like rank, dense rank, and so on, and custom specifications for frames. Currently, we have something like unbounded preceding up to current row, something like that. Next is projections.
Hey, Alexei.
Yeah.
Hey, we've got a question on window functions. If I could just throw it out to you, what on window functions? What about lag and lead? Are they planned?
Yeah. So this is not aggregate functions, but this is functions that should work with windows. And this is the next step. So we have to implement ranks and access to previous and next value.
And the row number is a very useful feature.
And row number, by the way, is already available if you write count.
Yeah, I know. But still.
Okay, so the next is projections. What is projections? It is multiple data representation inside single table. So when you create a table, you have to specify data order by expression. So range queries will work more efficient if you specify it order by correctly. But what if you need multiple different orders? You can create materialized view. But what if it will live inside single table and automatically available depending on your queries? What if you need some subset of columns in different order? Or what if you need to maintain some aggregation of data in consistent fashion? It is already possible with materialized views, but projections will give you multiple advantages. Projections will be always consistent and updated atomically. It will replicate data in the same way as the main table. And query optimizer will be able to select a projection with the most appropriate data representation. Work is already in progress. It is being implemented by Amos Bird, probably one of the top ClickHouse contributors. And he said me that it is already 90% done. What is the next? The next we are going to implement alternative to Zookeeper. For multiple reasons, people don't like Zookeeper. People usually fall in love with ClickHouse, but not in Zookeeper. Zookeeper is something unnatural to ClickHouse. So we are going to implement consensus protocol and service in ClickHouse directly. And it will give us multiple benefits. It will allow us to solve multiple issues that were not solvable before. But the most important is less operational complexity. So you don't have to install Zookeeper and to maintain it. The next can be considered as technical debt, but it is very important technical debt, and actually it is some technical decision that was made in ClickHouse, and we have to overcome it. It is evaluation of both sides of conditional expressions. So what will happen if you write the following query? You want to do a modulo of division by number. Sometimes number is zero, but you filter these numbers with if. If number is zero, just return zero. But ClickHouse evaluates both sides of expressions and returns you exception. The same for logical expressions and or. And even if you put one expression in subquery, it will not help because ClickHouse will optimize this query and put second expression inside a subquery. That's not good, that's not expected, and we have to implement short circuit evaluation. So this technical debt will be resolved. The next is quite a big topic. It is about user-defined functions. It is in design stage, and we are considering five different ways of implementation. We will select some ways, and we already selected two directions to implement. First is to allow define function as expression with already available functions in SQL. It can be quite limited approach because you have to combine your function with already available functions. The second way of implementation is allow users to write executable scripts or programs, and we will pipe arguments data to these scripts and receive results from a standard output. It is probably less efficient, but it will give you unlimited possibilities. You will be able to implement complex data classification tasks, machine learning tasks. You can embed your own business logic inside these scripts and use them as a functions in SQL. Hedged requests. What is hedged requests? Suppose you have a cluster with multiple data shards, hundreds of data shards, or even thousands. This is not unusual for ClickHouse because ClickHouse can scale quite well. When you execute distributed query across this cluster, it will send subqueries to every shard. And to do it, it will select one healthy replica in each shard. Sometimes replicas can be healthy, but some replicas can be significantly slower than other replicas. And it will give you much more latency that we want to mitigate. And the classic way to mitigate tail latencies is to send queries speculatively. So if some replica answering slowly, after some time, request will be sent to another replica speculatively, and then we will get the result from what replica will answer the first. This is already in progress. You can see the pull request and help us with review if you know C++. So also I want to highlight one additional feature that is a bonus. It is in our roadmap, but not in the list of main tasks. just a bonus. Native integration with PostgreSQL. So what if you want to query PostgreSQL server, PostgreSQL tables from ClickHouse? Recently, you have to use ODBC table function. ODBC table function is not the most convenient and not the most efficient way to query external databases. So now, ClickHouse, almost now, it will be available in next release. ClickHouse will have native support for PostgreSQL. It will be available as table engine and table function. Just type select from PostgreSQL, and that's it. It will be available as dictionary source and database engine. So you create your a database with PostgreSQL engine, and it will automatically contain all the tables from remote database on Postgres. So this is just a small bonus. And what is next? The next, I insist you to read our official roadmap, and you can read it right now. Just navigate to the list of ClickHouse issues and select this issue, 17623. And we can discuss the roadmap right now.
Thanks, Alexei. Hey, there's some questions that popped up that probably we can jump into. From the Postgres conversation, there's a question here. Can this feature be used as an automated import from Postgres?
Yes, and this is the next. Automatic replication from Postgres. Did you see the experimental feature named Materialize MySQL? So, this is the feature to replicate data from MySQL. It was implemented by developers from China, from two different companies. And it is still experimental, but in active development. So what about Postgres? For Postgres, we will implement similar feature. But I can say, and I can guarantee you, that this feature will be implemented by developers from Russia. I don't know what is better. Probably it is comparable. Maybe you have some preferences.
And then circling back to Zookeeper, that seems to be getting people kind of excited. The first question is, what's the ETA for Zookeeper removal? That's probably the biggest question.
So honestly speaking, I think it will be the second half of this year. Mm-hmm.
And then, okay, great. And then speaking of the Zookeeper replacement, are you implementing ZAB, the replication protocol, within ClickHouse and using replicas within a shard to reach Quorum?
It will be implemented on top of Raft, and it will be not necessarily to run the consensus inside the same ClickHouse nodes. You will still be able to run consensus servers on separate nodes. At least it will be more safe for the first time, but we will try to also allow to embed, to run it on the same nodes.
Will this support being able to do simpler replication topologies? So for example, one of the things we get a lot is being able to, people request a DR solution where they want to, they have a primary ClickHouse server, and this is pretty common in OEM or, you know, sort of embedded applications. They have a primary server, they're happy with that. It's got plenty of juice to solve queries. And what they'd like to do is have the equivalent of of ClickHouse replication going to another node, but maybe a really small one that's just accumulating parts. Is that, do you see that as somehow falling out of this work?
So what do you request is some kind of replication, but not from two sides, but only to one side, to some.
Right. Like it looks backup, like MySQL, basically.
Backup server for disaster recovery. Yep. So for this purpose, I recommend to use a distributed table with asynchronous insert. So you will create distributed table, and this table will send the same data in background to the backup server. It will not automatically maintain consistency between two servers, but it allow you to use very loose couplet replication. So main server is almost unaware about this backup server, and this backup server is just a backup. It does not change the behavior of the main server in any way. So probably it will be the solution for you, and it is already available.
All right, we have, looks like we're getting a number of, so here's a question from Ahmed. How will replication from Postgres behave if data gets updated in Postgres? That's sort of looking forward a bit.
Mm-hmm. We read replication protocol. It contains updates. It contains data from previous record and data from new record, and we insert these records to either replacing merge tree or collapsing merge tree. Mm-hmm. So you will be able to read updated data with a final modifier, or you will be able to read incompletely updated data that will be updated after some unspecified time.
Okay. Here's another question. When will you update the documentation? I'm actually not sure what that's referring to. I assume it's for Postgres.
This is a very generic question. Maybe it's about documentation in general. And it is from anonymous. So we regularly update the documentation, but for obvious reason, it can lag behind some recent features. So sometimes we made some feature available, but the documentation will be written just after a while. It is just normal to deliver features as soon as you want.
Yeah, and I know you and I have talked about that a lot, and we feel really guilty about it for everybody on this call. So we're going to try and get, because like Altinity did a lot of work on reading from S3, and we have still not published the docs. We have it scheduled, but it's coming. So Alexei, there's a somewhat longer question here. I don't know if you can see the Q&A box.
Yeah, I see.
Yeah, it's sort of about replacing merge tree. Maybe you can answer that one directly.
Yeah, but first I have to read it. So what about replacing merge tree? It does not guarantee the absence of duplicates. And the only way is to execute optimize final. So what about real-time deduplication? Currently, it is almost not possible. You can have real-time deduplication if you specify final modifier after from. Select from table final. But it can and it will slow down your query. Sometimes it can slow down it multiple times. And this is because we have to process these duplicates on select. So you pay for the duplication either on select or on insert. And we are looking for some ways of some compromise. Will it be possible to support real-time deduplication? And we find that it is doable for non-replicated tables, but it is significantly more hard to implement correctly and efficiently for replicated tables. So the question remains open. Sorry, microphone. I cannot hear you.
Speaking of open, we're really sort of transitioning into the office hours part of this. So I'll just read out the questions, and you or Denny or Alexander can answer them. There's a follow up on Zookeeper. Yeah, I knew this would excite people. A follow-up to the previous question, given that Raft has been chosen as an independent consensus protocol, does it imply future compatibility with etcd?
No, because it is on the different levels. Raft is just consensus protocol, and etcd is a service and data model on top of this consensus protocol. So these are completely independent tasks, and I can guarantee about replacement for Zookeeper and better to say nothing about etcd.
So probably it will be implemented in Treehouse, and you don't need nor Zookeeper nor etcd.
Right. Good. We have another one that just popped up from Hasitha. Can I know the performance benefit of optimized skip unused shards versus reading all shards?
One query using all shards, it has to send the query to every shard and get the answer. The answer will be received very quickly, because it has nothing to read from these shards, but it's still a network request, and you will still pay for this network request. And if you have multiple short queries on ClickHouse, the server can be overloaded. It is not good to have multiple thousands of queries on single server, even if every query is very short. And also, multiple network requests are not good because network is not always reliable. Even if you have very good network inside your data center, you still have to assume that network is not always reliable. So the less number of network requests is better.
And still, maybe your queries, they actually not so cheap from index perspective. So it may be not on index, and maybe they are not partitioned, eliminated. So you will get improval even for short, very fast queries, because you don't need to scan a primary key and so on, and you don't need to do check partitions and so on. So you will get, but it's for almost real time for very fast. It's usable for very fast, for very short queries mostly.
Great. Hey, got a question that more Zookeeper questions coming in. If you replace Zookeeper, will there still be deduplication? That's coming in off the YouTube channel.
Yes, we have to implement it in a 100% compatible way. So the visible behavior will not change, except it will become just better.
Great. More questions. So please feel free to queue them up. We're here to answer these. So got one from Adam Peavy. Traditionally, ColumnDBs use a row-oriented database to cache writes and ingest into the ColumnDB in batches. Row-oriented databases are optimized for writes versus column, which are for reads, presumably. For high throughput writes into ClickHouse, is this necessary?
Sorry, I have some lags, but okay, it's normal. So about some cache for writes. It's not just about column-oriented with row-oriented. If you did not miss our previous meetup, I announced a new feature named Compact Data Parts. And compact data parts are write optimized. But they are not row oriented. They contain the same columns, but the same columns is in less amount of files in file system. And compact data parts can significantly improve write throughput. And also we have in-memory data parts. In-memory with write ahead log. When you insert data, it will be still inserted in column-oriented format, but in memory. And I see no reason to use row-oriented cache.
So if you're asking about sorts of Vertica and I don't remember, they have such feature, but ClickHouse is much faster even without this feature. So on ingestion, on insert, so ClickHouse doesn't need it. And ClickHouse has a buffer engine. And I know that Alexey has some ideas about implementing a new feature and to do single inserts.
For anybody who's interested in this topic, we did a webinar last month on high performance inserts, and it covered these three new part types. So if you flip back, and Alexander, I don't know if you want to comment on that. That was your webinar.
I'm third to Alexey and Denise on that ClickHouse current implementation of compact and in-memory data parts allows us to have pretty high for output inserts. It's certainly not as fast as you can do with Cassandra or Mongo, but it's not supposed to be as fast as those row-level databases.
And okay. Also, if you just want to have some row-oriented cache, before in front of ClickHouse, you can just pipe your data into Kafka. And ClickHouse will read data from Kafka for you.
Yeah, and there was actually a question on that that's a follow-up from one of the previous ones. We'll take that now. So from Hasitha, regarding the skip shards explanation, what if we write data to the local table via a Kafka table directly? Is it okay then to read the data via a distributed table with optimized unused shard or skip unused shards? If you see that question.
Yeah, it is perfectly okay in case if you write data to correct shard. So if you respect the sharding schema, if you write your data to wrong shard, it will just not be found. when the setting optimize skip unused charts is enabled.
Yeah, so it's you can use several approaches actually. The performant one and the hard one. For example, you can chart your data before ClickHouse by different topics in Kafka and then just different topics on different shards. So your data will be already sharded and you every shard you read from specific topic and the data which is needed for this shard. It's a hard one, but it's very performant. It's very good way. Another way you can actually use a distributed table in materiality view for Kafka engine. So the ClickHouse will be shard the data, will be shard data for you. So you ingest by Kafka engine, for example, on any shard or data on any shard and using materiality view, you insert not into merge tree or replicated merge tree table, but into a distributed table, two distributed table. And then ClickHouse distributed table gets the data from Kafka engine and distribute data for you into underlying merge tree tables and data will be sharded for you as you want. But this way has obvious performance impact, but people use distributed tables for data ingest, so it's kind of normal maybe.
Okay, I'm gonna skip around. We have a question. I just wanna make sure that we get a wide variety of questions answered and everybody gets a chance to have at least one important one covered. We still got plenty of time. Here's a great one from Deepak. Do you have any thoughts on implementing token-based access control, like using a time-limited token to provide access? Somebody want to take that one?
Yes, this is actually in our roadmap. And we're considering different kind of tokens. So one example is JWT, is it JSON web token or something like that?
Yeah.
Another example is implementing support for OAuth. So you will be able to authenticate users that obtain their tokens from third-party service. But it is still, it is not in progress. We just have it in our roadmap.
Okay, great. And one thing that's worth mentioning in passing, we did the implementation at Altinity for LDAP. So that's yet another way that you can do authentication. That's actually pretty pretty stable at this point, lacking a little documentation, which should be fixed pretty quickly here. Here's a question about backup from Svetoslav. Interested in a backup solution just in case. Native file is quite huge in our use case. Could not pipe output to a compressed file. What we do is export ClickHouse data to native format and then use symlink bzip2, bunzip2, bzcattails zip2, so on and so forth. Is there any way to export ClickHouse data in compressed format to a remote backup server? And,
there is some ways how to do it. You can run ClickHouse client and select data with native format. And in the same statement, pipe data into GZ, BZIP2, or ZSTD. So it will create a compressed data file on the fly without creating temporary file.
You know, the other thing to do is to look at, I don't know, Svetoslav, if you're looking at ClickHouse backup, Yeah, that's
may I speak?
Yeah, go for it. Go for it. Glad you're because unmuted. And
I tried. Okay, I tried doing what he said, but the output file was not compressed at all. For example, it was like in our case 43 gigabytes, and when I did what he said, it was again the same size, so it was not compressed when piped out. So what we did was exported in the native format, and then the backup server compresses it to BZ2 on its own. This way it worked, but with the pipe out to a compressed file, it was resulting with the same file size, just different extension. And since we are using the latest version of ClickHouse, and I saw that ClickHouse backup doesn't support it because of atomic writes or something else as well. I don't remember the exact limitations now, but what I saw is that the version we use is not supported. We use the latest version. I think it was released the other day. And this is something, the backup solution, we are writing it just now. Like we started like, I don't know, a couple of days ago with the previous version and the last version, which was just released. So I think the ClickHouse backup script is not suitable for our case yet.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right. That database Atomic is currently not supported because it completely changes the structure of the data. And we are currently working on fixing that. So it's a work in progress, and I hope it will be released by the end of month.
Okay, we'll be following it to see if we can implement that. Thanks. But again, what we tried to pipe out it that directly didn't really work. It only changed the extension of the file, and it was the same size. So I guess we're good to go with what we have right now. And it doesn't require locking the data because it's being constantly inserted in this table.
So, okay. But I cannot believe it does not work. If you just run ClickHouse client and pipe its output to JZ, it has to work.
Okay, but then we have to limit it with, for example, with CS Stream, and it's really, really slow, even over gigabit networks, and it would take hours to do so. And without this compression, it works for like 5 minutes. To send this 43 gigabytes file to the backup server.
By the way, you can also create compressed files on server side. Maybe for some fun, I will share my screen and try to show some commands.
Okay.
So I already have ClickHouse server running directly on my desktop, and I will try to write insert into table function file, and I will try to remember the order of arguments. Something like this. Yes, it works, and I will locate this file on the server. In the user files directory. You can see this file and it must be compressed. If I did not miss something.
Okay, I guess we should try again. There's something we're missing. Okay.
Okay.
Well, I'll take a screenshot of that if you don't mind.
Yes, you can take the screenshot, and recording will also be available.
Oh, okay. Right. Okay, thank you.
Also, if I remember correctly, it is possible to specify compression directly in additional argument. Yes. You can try GZ, Brotli, ZSTD, and XZ.
Okay. We found out that BZ2 is actually best in compressing large files, so I guess we'll try that and then what you suggested to compare the result. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Great. Okay. So, yeah, and on backups, if anybody, that's something that we're super interested in as well at Altinity. So if you do see backup issues, definitely log them. A question here for Filippo, from Filippo. Questions around support for AVX 512 extensions. Issue 117, this is kind of hard to read. Blah, blah, blah. Are there plans to extend this support to more functions? This sounds like one for you, Alexei.
We don't have plans to support more functions. But right now, it is possible. And you can see the examples that are already implemented. So you can easily implement more specializations. Currently, AVX 512 is still not widely supported, but for some functions, it will definitely give some benefits. So it's up to our contributors.
Okay. Good. Getting down toward the, if people, you know, if you have more questions, feel free to queue them up. We're not going anywhere for a little bit. So here's one. Do you have a suggestion for a strategy if I have live data that keeps updating for about 24 hours, then later freeze? How can I handle that if I want to guarantee correct results with the least performance punishment?
It depends on how exactly this data is updated. Sometimes you can just track every update as a separate event and calculate the resulting data on the fly from these events. It is named event sourcing. So you, instead of updating your data, you just record all events. And after 24 hours, you can do a query to calculate final data from these events. But this is just one way. Sometimes it's not applicable.
Okay. One more question in the chat, and then we've got some still pending on YouTube that we'll get to. So you YouTube folks, hang tight there. We'll be right there. There's this last question. Alexei, I don't know if you can see this one. Aggregate function of another aggregation function is actually not possible. Is the only way that we have now is the use of aggregate function combinators, or is it planned to develop this feature at a later time?
Actually, you can do aggregation on top of another aggregation, just use the subqueries. Write one aggregate function inside the subquery and another aggregate function outside of subquery. But if you write directly something like average of minimum of X, it does not have clear semantics. It is not supported in standard SQL. And it's unclear how to even come up with some support.
Okay, thanks. YouTube questions, let me just read out a few. There's some good ones here. Here's one regarding the UDF feature. We know it got dropped on the floor previously. is there a design doc for this or an ETA kicking this feature off? Now, you talked about this on your talk, but is there a design doc as well as an ETA on it?
Currently, there is no open publicly available design doc. Actually, we have it, but it is in Russian language and it is posted on one on our internal Telegram chats. So it is not available. But I think we will make it available about ETA. Currently, no ETA, just 2021.
Okay. Here's another one, actually a great question from YouTube. Are there any plans to implement auto sharding when scaling the number of nodes?
It is very anticipated feature, but also it is very difficult to implement. And I am not brave enough to put it in roadmap for year 2021. So if everything, if we will be really, really lucky, we are going to implement it. But it depends. I don't know what year 2021 will be actually.
Okay, so I feel free to come back and ask that one at a future office hours. It sounds like we may be able to, we may give you the same answer though. Here's a great one. Is there any plan for cost-based query optimization?
We will have to implement some basic cost-based query optimization to support partition projection selection. So it is unavoidable.
Okay.
Right,
yeah,
now
that's
because, right now, Pickles doesn't need much cost-based optimization because it's nothing to optimize mostly. No, only maybe choose what table on, to put on the left or on the right if you do join. So mostly it's for selecting what index to use, but Clickhouse has only primary key and it's index organized table, so it's nothing to choose.
By the way, we already have rudimentary support for cost-based optimization to select conditions to move to prevare.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so okay, great. So it sounds like it's kind of incrementally getting added. Let's see. Oh, here's an interesting one. Has anyone run ClickHouse on the Apple Silicon, natively on the Apple Silicon M1 processor? If yes, how does it do for performance?
I know that people successfully compile ClickHouse on Apple Silicon, but I don't know the performance results. I don't have the hardware with Apple Silicon yet. It will be very interesting to evaluate it. By the way, we already have performance results from other ARM hardware because there is not only Apple Silicon, there are many more servers based on ARM64 architecture. For example, there is AWS Graviton. There is chips and servers from Huawei. We tested all of them and the results are promising. So ARM64 architecture can at least compare, and sometimes it can even outperform x86-64. It cannot outperform the best servers, but it is at least comparable. By the way, let me post a link with performance results that are crowdsourced results for different hardware. 1 minute. I will post it to Zoom chat.
Great.
Not yet. This. And also I will post it on YouTube. One moment. Here is the link.
There's another, actually there's another question, Alexei, off YouTube that we can jump into. Is it possible to do complex event processing or CEP with ClickHouse? I'll throw that out there to you guys. I don't know enough about what that is to say who should answer.
It is doable, but only in some simple cases. Maybe someone else would like to answer, because I just briefly know what is complex event processing, but I have no much experience with these systems.
I think partially it can be done with live views, because live view, it's essentially the query on the stream of the data, which is updatable with the data. It's not completely what CEP systems do, but pretty close. Actually, every tool needs to solve its own task. There are dedicated databases for complex event processing, and ClickHouse was never considered as one of them, but at some limited extent it can be used, yeah.
What I can understand is that with these systems, you can create some alerts and metrics on top of streams of data. Sometimes it is already possible in ClickHouse using aggregated materialized views. So you create aggregated materialized views that will do incremental aggregation in real time. As you insert your data, aggregations will be recounted, and you can select aggregated data and create alerts on top of them.
Okay. Back to the question list. Here's one. Can you say something about the optimal partitioning strategy? There was an Altinity post that talked about over partitioning, but what about under partitioning?
Actually, if your table is not very large, it is fine to not have any partitioning at all. Just omit partition by in create table and it will work. Partitioning is required mostly for data manipulation. When you will move partition between tables or drop partition instantly, or for mutations. But sometimes you just don't need partitions at all. Sorry, I don't.
Oops. Nope, I had to get. Okay, there's a final question here. Do you have any benchmarks for different cloud providers and their different hardware specs? And I think you partially answered that with the benchmark hardware. I do not know of anything, though, specifically around cloud providers.
There are some tests for some cloud configurations, but not for every cloud provider, mostly just for single Amazon. There are multiple different configurations. And it will be a huge undertaking to compare them all. But I will be happy if you will create some VM, run our tests. By the way, they are completely automated. It will take about 20 minutes to run our tests. So I will be happy if you run them and send the results.
Great. Here's a question. I'm wondering why there's no native integration with RabbitMQ similar to Kafka.
This is just untrue. We do have native integration with RabbitMQ, and many people already using it in production. You just missed our previous meetups.
Okay, so they can just look in the docs for that one?
I will check. Do we have it in docs? if we don't,
I was just raising our guilt level.
If we don't have in docs, at least we have examples in tests.
Yeah, and while
yes, we have.
Cool. If I could put a shout out here, if you're looking for ways to contribute to ClickHouse, docs are a great way. We need help there. Altinity, Alexis and Yandex have done a wonderful job on this, putting out and managing what's there. We just hired a person at Altinity, but this is just something where it helps make the ClickHouse better and easier to use, and it's a really easy way to do PRs. In fact, that's the only way I've contributed. So please do consider doing it. It really helps ClickHouse.
Just small advertisement. Do you know about system contributors table inside ClickHouse? Try to type select star from system.contributors. You will see multiple people, about 800. But do you see yourself in the list? To get into this list, just send any pull request, even a small one. Even a pull request in documentation will count. And you will be automatically added to the list into system contributors table on every ClickHouse server that runs in production in thousands of companies.
Okay, I think we're, let me just check here. I think we've gone through most of the answers. Looks like we're, getting into the bottom, just double checking the chat. How are we doing over on, looks like we got all the questions on YouTube. So at this point, it's getting really late for both Alexi and Alexander. I know it must be near 1 a.m. for you. There's a question here. Can you share the documentation Git repo? Actually, that is ClickHouse.
Yes, just look at the docs directory. Yeah.
Yep. And if you want to do a PR, it's really easy. There's a little pencil. If you want to fix a doc, there's a little pencil, just hit it, it'll automatically create a merge. It's probably the easiest way you can commit something to ClickHouse by far, and they get accepted very quickly. So with that, I think Alexi and Denise and Alexander, I think we'll call it a day. Thank you very, very much, all of you, for participating. I know for Alexander and Alexi staying up late. And thanks to everybody in the crowd for asking a bunch of great questions. We will be doing, as I think I mentioned, our next meetup will be in February. I haven't scheduled it yet, but we're looking for topics. If you want to talk about great things that you're doing, please let us know and join us. We'll look forward to seeing you next month.
Okay, thank you.
All right, thanks and good night. Bye, everybody.
Bye.
Bye.
Thanks.